HarperCollins presents The Lost Prescription, A Practical Roadmap to Grief Recovery, written and read by Dr. Chloe Paidoussis-Mitchell. Please note that there is a download file in your audiobook library, which includes supporting material for some of the exercises in this audiobook, as well as further resources. Introduction. We bereaved are not alone. We belong to the largest company in all the world, the company of those who have known suffering. Helen Keller. My heart is broken. Without her, my world is pointless. These words were spoken by Rachel, a 44-year-old client who had lost a 19-year-old daughter to leukemia 8 months previously and had come to my practice for therapy. She had been so strong, so determined to support her vulnerable girl to the end. And she had. But the shattered pieces of her broken heart were too depressed, too exhausted, and too fragmented to find anything positive to move towards. She collapsed into the therapy chair, seeking some acknowledgement of her despair. She wept and wept in rage, confusion, and despair. She wanted her girl back, and she was so angry. How could something so cruel happen to such an amazing young woman? My work with Rachel was humbling and poignant. Listening to this book, you may hear a version of your own story in hers. My first words to her were, "I'm so sorry for your loss." I offer these same words to you right now to recognize what you're going through. I'm sorry on that human level. I know, as we all do, that none of us gets out of this alive. I know that none of us can live a life untouched by loss and grief, and yet I also know how painful it is to bear a severed bond. I share in your sadness and I empathize deeply with what it's like to be touched by pain. If you're listening to this, I imagine you're dealing with a loss or supporting someone who's dealing with a loss. Perhaps loss through bereavement, loss through life change such as divorce, miscarriage or retirement, or loss that's historical. You may be in the early stages of loss. Perhaps it's only been a few days. Or you may be much further down the line, wondering, as your heartache weaves its intricate tapestry, if you will ever be whole again. Whatever it is, losing pushes you to your limits. But support is out there. In this book, I offer you a roadmap to recover your psychological and physical equilibrium, well-being, and mental health. Recovery doesn't mean the absence of sadness. It means accepting sadness and living fully anyway. People often say you don't overcome grief. And it's true. It is something you move through and learn to live with. But embracing life again, living fully, and experiencing joy and happiness no matter what, is possible. It is important. It matters because you matter. In this book, I promise to help you find your inner calm, reach a place of acceptance, find hope, and reconstruct your life as meaningfully as you desire. There are so many grief theories and so many different approaches. There are many books on grief. Many of them are brilliant. I have written this one, however, because I have not found a book that offers a therapeutic roadmap through loss of any kind. A book that uses a holistic approach to address what grief does to us, looking at the whole person, and offering the types of tools and solutions you might encounter if you were to enter a therapist's room. As a psychologist with a private clinic in London, I know that therapy is expensive and the waiting times are long. I wanted more people to have access to the kind of expertise that might help them recover. And in this book, I present the tools I have used for many years with my clients, several of whom you'll meet along the way, along with accessible information on what to expect of grief and what may unfold. Engaging with the loss prescription is a deep dive into your soul. It is going to be challenging. Part of this may be because in the West, we don't deal with loss and grief all that well. Why are we so bad at dealing with loss? As you have likely discovered, loss of any kind that deprives you of a hoped-for future is unimaginably difficult. Nothing prepares you for it. Even when you know it's coming, those first weeks are raw. If your mind feels foggy and overwhelmed, your heart hurts, your body is tense, and you have lost your sense of self, that's all completely understandable. Grief ebbs and flows, sometimes manageably, and other times, less so. Funerals and memorial rituals give us structure in the early stages of a bereavement, and we often assume that life will return to normal after a few months, believing that most people progress through grief and come out the other side, resembling their previous self. My experience, however, is that many, especially after the initial phase of loss, feel alone, unsupported, often adrift. During my training in the NHS at the turn of the millennium, almost every case of depression, anxiety, addiction, or severe mental illness that was referred to me for therapy included the trauma of poorly processed loss, accompanied by disconnection and neglect, often starting in childhood or adolescence and repeating in adulthood. The COVID-19 pandemic showed how much loss is all around us all the time, but our post-pandemic attitude is still avoidant of grief. Somehow, somewhere along the line, we have fallen into a pattern of performing, of masking our loss and pretending to be okay, despite our inner struggles. The structures we live within support this idea. In the UK, there is still no legislation on bereavement leave, and how much time you have off work after a loss depends on the personal perspective of your boss. But what happens if you lose a cherished friend, or a colleague dies by suicide, or you go through a divorce? What happens if you get diagnosed with cancer or suffer a miscarriage? There is so much loss in so many ways, and instead of having discussions and policies to help people in those moments of crisis, we make oppressively optimistic suggestions, such as, shouldn't you be over it by now? This collective mindset fails to acknowledge that the only way through grief is to face the fear it evokes, to travel through it, and to find growth in it. I repeatedly hear how bereaved people resist asking for help for fear of being judged or rejected. They internalize their grief or cope with it alone, searching for answers outside of them. When I achieve this, when I make that move, I will be okay. Or if I fill my life up with busyness, that will distract me and that will help. In the short term, being constantly busy can provide some respite from the rawness of a devastating loss. I certainly have used this as a survival strategy to give some temporary relief from the intensity of grief. But if you put all your energy into avoidance and distraction, you are eventually risking your mental health and recovery. Repression causes depression, and the longer that goes on, the tougher it is to get out of it. Whilst I'm not laboring under the illusion that I can change society's attitudes to grief in one book, I hope that I can help you feel supported on a personal level. This book will help you learn how to restore yourself mentally, physically, socially, emotionally, and spiritually to undertake a healing journey. The healing journey. Loss is always complex. Sometimes we lose wonderfully fulfilling and uncomplicated relationships. Other times we lose people we have not had easy relationships with. But if we love, we grieve. We mourn all that we love and have included in the fabric of our lives, even difficult, complex, and flawed characters, real human beings who sometimes said hurtful things or had unhelpful perspectives on life and relationships. Sometimes the hole left behind is huge, sometimes surprisingly so. Whatever and whoever you are grieving, to heal, you have to face it, to honour the reality of it. It might be that all you want to do is resist it, but recovery involves letting go of the need to control or change reality. The only thing you can control is your response to it. Once you accept this, you can begin to process it. You will do this in your own way. You may be hoping that I will tell you what to think and do, but I'm not in the business of telling people what to think or feel. I'm in the business of listening and holding the space so that they can help and heal themselves. As a clinician, I have found huge comfort in seeing the gift in life, no matter what the suffering. I don't mean to be toxically positive here, imposing a cheeriness which casts an oppressive spell on everyone. I mean that I have observed how honouring the reality of grief shows us that we're capable of making the most of life, even in the worst of circumstances, creating meaning, giving back, helping others, building meaningful and authentic connections, honouring our love for who and what we have lost. I have seen how growth comes out of loss. Bereaved people grieve and find love and happiness again. They create new connections. They heal. They help others. This is your journey from now on. You may feel there is no way of getting over what has happened, of getting your life back. In truth, you won't get it back. Your old life is done. You will never be your old self again. What you can do, however, is evolve. You can rebuild your life and anchor in hope and purpose. You can be the author of your story. You can and will heal. Grief might be a significant part of your story, but it doesn't have to be the defining feature of your life. What happens next is up to you. How do I know this? My story. I've worked in the field of trauma and loss since the late 1990s and have dedicated my adult professional life to researching grief, raising awareness in the workplace on grief, running my private practice, the Grief Clinic in London, and writing articles and talking in the media about how we recover our mental health in the face of grief. This work matters to me because I know how difficult it is to live with grief and how lonely it can be. I, like everyone else, have experienced loss and have found that the toughest part is finding a way to express it in a state of acceptance and love. The two losses that have stayed with me for a very long time both happened to me in my early 30s. One of them was a miscarriage, a few hours before I was about to board a plane, and the other was a diagnosis of a serious and chronic autoimmune illness that I have never heard of before, familial Mediterranean fever, FMF, with amyloidosis. I was not prepared for either of these losses, and their impact was profound. On the day of my miscarriage, I felt a deep emptiness, an overwhelming sense of helplessness, while struggling to stay calm and functional. I was in the middle of packing, anxious about traveling back to London with my one-year-old son and wondering how to cope with the reality of what was happening to my body. The stress was immense. My body felt deeply dysregulated. I was sick. I shook. My hands trembled. My mind felt foggy. I couldn't think straight. I felt afraid of what was happening and shocked that I could do nothing to prevent it from happening. It was a bleak day, and the aftershock of it stayed with me for years. I lost that baby and threw myself into my studies, focusing on learning as much as I could about loss of all kinds. I enjoyed the opportunity to help others, and I did heal, but it took a while. At first, I compartmentalized the loss. I didn't share it with anyone. I distracted myself and I focused on what I could do. Taking action helped me cope. As a professional, however, I knew that I was doing it all wrong. Burying my fear and the pain of loss only led to it resurfacing when I fell pregnant again. That was when I processed it. Therapy helped. Finding ways to observe my grief helped me grow. The loss of my health followed a period of about 8 years of chronic poor health with constant fevers and fatigue. I had been dismissed by countless doctors who kept telling me it was stress. I knew it wasn't. When I was finally diagnosed with FMF, even though I had been living with illness for almost a decade, it landed on me like a ton of bricks. That was it. I would never wake up feeling well again. There are very few words I can share with you to describe the shock and sadness I felt. Health is such a privilege, and losing it is painful, frightening, and lonely. The toughest phase lasted about 6 months, during which I underwent a battery of tests and had very little knowledge as to what came next. The uncertainty was disorientating and frightening. Amyloidosis is a condition where deposits of a protein called amyloid build around vital organs. It is a fatal condition. I couldn't bear to discuss it with anyone, so I didn't. I felt deeply alienated and othered in my experience. On the one hand, I knew I was lucky. I had expert specialist support, the best in the world, for free in London. On the other, I wondered what would happen if this was it. I threw myself into my work, a usual strategy of mine when the going gets tough, and shared very little until I knew more concretely what I was dealing with. I spent this time reflecting and accepting that life was both precious and fleeting. And my way through this would be with love. Love for myself, love for my children, love for my husband and family. In the 5 years since my diagnosis, I have navigated a grief with so many shapes. Questions about prognosis, issues surrounding daily medication, which makes me nauseous and threatens my organ health, monthly blood tests, lifestyle limits, and loneliness have all required handling and processing. My relationships have changed. My depleted health is a constant reminder of my mortality, but my losses have helped me appreciate the gift of life more. I now value every day, good or bad. I pace myself when I need to, and I can look after myself. I have a high chance of not making it into old age, but I feel at peace with that now. I have hope, and I have insight. My most important learning about loss has been to face it, and to do so in a state of acceptance, calm, and openness. I find anchoring in my work. It is work I can thankfully do most of the time. I'm grateful for this. It gives me a huge sense of purpose, and over the last few years...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.